This video is about GitRust Data Type Manager, GitRust Data Type Archives, and GitRust Parse C Source feature. GitRust allows you to manage data types via the Data Type Manager. You can see it here. It has several built-in types that you can see here. For example, byte, char, and many others. Then here in red are the data types of your current project. These are either data types that have been imported from the built-in data types or from other data type archives that are loaded by the program. Or these are data types that you defined by analyzing functions. For example, by editing a function signature, you can then import the data type into the project. Caption function data types. And as you can see here, in the data types of your projects, there's stuff, for example, like the PE header. There are the structs of the PE header that are at the beginning of the program. These analyzers here, this is simply an overlay of a struct in GitRa. Then next are additionally loaded GitRa data type archives. In this case, it's the default Windows Visual Studio 2012 32-bit data type archive. And you can see in here, it has all the header files of the Visual Studio 2012 in it. And then, for example, you can look inside the functions, and then you have all the defined functions with its signatures. And every time that GitRa notices one of these function names in a program during analysis, it will assign it this function signature. Then next, however, what do you do when you recognize a function, a struct, or some other data type inside your program that you don't have a data type archive for it yet? One way of doing it would be to edit the function signature. However, you have to do this for every function that you encounter, and this is not practical. Let's say, for example, you already have some source code for some defines, some type defs, some structs, and some functions. Then what GitRa allows you to do is use the parse C source to actually import this function. And here on the top you have the parse configurations. There are some default parse configurations. For example, if you want to parse the Visual Studio 12 headers on a 32-bit system, this would look like this. Here on the top you have the source files that need to be parsed. These need to be in the correct order. So if a later source file needs an earlier source file, you need to include that earlier source file earlier in the process. Then down here, you have the parse options, and these are basically compiler switches. For example, the dash I gives you an include path that the compiler will look for additional includes. Hence, you don't need to have a complete directory here, but can simply have the file, and the parser will then look in these directories. Then you have the dash D, that's to define preprocessor defines. Then addition to the dash D, this is undocumented, but it's in the source code. You also have the dash U, which means to undefine a define. And then you have the dash V for the verbosity of the output, or the dash O for outputting some debug information. But you don't need to use dash V, dash O, and dash U. For our simple example, all we need is to pass to the header file, and we can leave the rest empty. And then we can hit parse to program or parse to file. Parse to file will generate a GDT file, a GitRa data type archive, but we want to have our types directly in the program for now. What happens next is it will use already open archives to look up data types that are not defined in the header files that you're scanning. And in case it uses data types of this archive, it will depend on that archive, on the data types. And then we hit continue. And then it has successfully parsed our header file. And then we can look in here, and then we see our test.h. And there we have our defines, and we have our functions with the correct data types. And then we also have our struct. And what you can then do to apply this to our program, let's say rename this function foobar. Now we know we have a foobar function here. However, this has not been applied the data type of this foobar function. Now what we can do is we right click here and then apply function data types. And then we see Gidra recognizes that there is a function named foobar and it applied automatically the function signature to it. Obviously this in this case it's incorrect, but this is how you can automatically apply imported data types. Now, how can you use this on a much larger scale? For example, you have here the internet open URL A, which is imported from the WinENet DLL, which is not recognized because it's not in the Windows Visual Studio headers. And that's when you can do, for example, what I've done. You can parse, for example, the existing headers of the WinRP. I parsed the headers of the Minimagnu for Windows headers on my Linux system because the Gidra parser isn't really that good and I couldn't parse any Windows SDK headers and I had some problems and hence I had to do a little clutch, put all the files into one file, otherwise I would get errors from the parser. But you don't need to worry about this because all you need to do is download the data type archive and then open file archive. And then you open the WinAPI32. And then you see that down here appearing. Now the data type is not defined yet, but again, apply function data types. And as we can now see, we have correct function data types with correct names and everything. And this also affects the way that the decompiler analyzes a program. For example, it has now recognized that this is of type H internet. So it does type propagation already. Next, a neat little trick that you can apply. For example, if you're often analyzing in the listing view, you don't often see where each parameter is loaded. That's when you can do the x86 propagate external parameters analysis. And what it will do, it will propagate the parameter names of an external call via comments in the analysis. So now see here for each push, you know exactly what is pushed.